Rose Larkin is on the run after narrowly escaping a hit intended for her aunt and uncle. She calls for help, and Peter Sutherland answers the call, and as a result is sucked into a vast conspiracy involving a mole at the highest levels of the United States government. He is the Night Agent. I'm Ronald Young Jr., and I'm on the couch. All right, this is Ronald, and I am on the couch after watching The Night Agent. The Night Agent on Netflix. Created by Shawn Ryan, based on the novel The Night Agent by Matthew Quirk, starring Gabriel Basso, Luciane Buchanan, Fola, Evans-Akingbola, Sarah Desjardins, Eve Harlow, Phoenix Raei, DB Woodside, and Hong Chau. And for a complete cast listing, as always, you can check out the link in our show notes. So if I'm being honest, this was a show that kind of, it kind of fell into my lap because this is a slow time for movies. We just got done with Oscars. We're not quite to summer yet. We're probably a few weeks away from really starting to get like the hits rolling in. I think next week I'll be reviewing the Super Mario Brothers, but that's like really the first big like summer, pre-summer, like we're done with spring. Now movies are about to be blockbusters in the theater again. So we're kind of in an in-between place and we're kind of, you know, headed towards spring, summer, where television isn't necessarily putting out their best right now either. A lot of that stuff is holding till fall. A lot of people are wrapping up, whatever. But streaming is different. Streaming, you can put out stuff whenever. You kind of find out, you find it when you find it when it comes to streaming. It just shows up on your box. Next thing you know, you got that new season of Love is Blind. Things are going. Also, we'll be covering Love is Blind in Patreon soon enough. The Night Agent just kind of fell into my lap. Noticed that it was the number one show on Netflix, number two, again, being Love is Blind. And I saw it and I was like, huh, that seems like maybe that's something I should do for On the Couch. So I was like, I'll watch a couple episodes, see what it's all about. Man, I turned this show on and I could not turn it off. I binged straight through 10 episodes. It took me about, I actually had to slow down in order to kind of like stretch it out because I was not ready for it to go. This is an exciting and fun show. This show reminds me of 90s political thrillers. Think In the Line of Fire. Think The Eraser with Arnold Schwarzenegger. 24, early on, like in the early aughts. Think all of those movies. Put those together. The Fugitive is a little bit in there too. All of these things are like kind of like swirled together in this series. The premise of the series is that there is a young FBI agent who is assigned to be basically a phone operator by the White House, by the president's chief of staff, played by Hong Chau, who is having quite a run right now. I didn't even expect her to be in a show like this, but she is, you know, pretty significant in this show. And essentially, he answers the phone one night, and that's kind of what kicks off the plot. It's a good show. Like, it's a good show. Like, it's everything you would expect from all of the kind of things that I just mentioned before. But it's just like, because it's on Netflix, there's a few ways in which they kind of subvert the tropes, the things that would irritate me to begin with. You know, first of all, if you look at the front of the cover, it's the Night Agent. And you see Gabriel Basso on the front and you're just expecting it to be all about him. Well, he is the star of the show, but very quickly, as he is running around with Luciane Buchanan, she's no damsel in distress. She is useful. He heeds her advice. They are working together. They are partners. And watching them be partners in this, it kind of like subverts the whole idea where there's one person that's kind of doing all the work, one grizzly FBI agent who can fight and who knows how to do everything and is somehow good at computers. Whereas this one, they actually tackle all of their problems together. And I really appreciated that. It felt refreshing. It felt like I was watching something where I was like, oh, okay, so they're teammates. It just made it seem like you weren't necessarily counting on this guy to have all the answers. He really needed to lean on her for support. And she was also unwilling to let him just sideline her whenever there was danger. She was like, no, we're going to go in this together. She has a wrong done to her early in the movie. And she was like, I need to find out. Oh, I'm sorry, early in the show. I need to find out who did this wrong. So we're in this together. Now, I will say the only, I think, drawback to this, and I will say there's an intersecting plot between two Secret Service agents, one of them played by D.B. Woodside, who I believe, if I'm not mistaken, he played the president's brother in 24, which I was like, wow, what an appropriate casting for him to go from being the president's brother. And I think at one point he is the president to being a Secret Service agent in this film. It's a show. In this show. So that plot intersects. And I think at that point, when it starts to become kind of this bigger conspiracy theory mystery, I'm like, okay, I'm all in. I remember thinking in the first 3 to 4 episodes, I don't know how long I can watch these two just kind of run around and try to clear their name. But this other intersecting plot kind of picks up and it becomes very, like, very important, like something that I'm also compelled and wanting to watch. Another relationship between two Secret Service agents that's like they're trying to figure out each other, but also there's something that's unfolding behind them. And they're just as important to the plot as the main two people. It's like it's a subplot that like gets promoted to main plot halfway through the series. That's all good. Now, let me tell you the only bad thing about this show. The only bad thing about this show is there's also a set of assassins in this show that I think are given way too much screen time and way too much character development. I mean, when we see them initially, they are doing something outright evil, horrible. They're doing something bad. And then, like, the show decides it wants to humanize them a little. And the problem with that is, and I would say with all the villains on this show, is there's ways in which they didn't exactly nail them for being, because typically I think the new idea of a villain is like, oh, I could agree. I could see why they did what they did. And I think there's probably only one villain in this show who I'm like, I can see why this person did what they did. But everyone else is so cartoonishly evil. And especially these two assassins who they kind of like turn into these like sadists at one point who are kind of enjoying the pain that they're inflicting on folks. And for the rest of the show to be pretty straightforward, this portion just felt very out of place and a little unbalanced for me. And luckily, when their part of the plot ends, I felt like the show kind of picked up where I think it should have stayed, which is just like, hey, you know, we're up against the government. We're up against this conspiracy of people doing this thing that they think is right, but is ultimately wrong. You know, it's the wrong thing to do. And there was enough other evil people involved in all of the show that I just don't think that you needed to give me character development on two kind of flat characters to begin with. And I don't think they needed to be anything more than flat. They just needed to be evil assassins, nameless, not talking assassins. And I think that would have been perfectly fine. But it wasn't that. And I think that was the part of this that kind of made this show not as good as I think it could have been. That being said, it's a really good show. For it to show up on Netflix and for me to be watching it on my couch, I was intrigued. This is a great show to watch with your spouses, with your parents, with your kids. I mean, it's not that violent. PG-13, definitely. And there's some F words in there, but it's like the F word, the way that they use it now on streaming, where it's not them just being like out here just saying F all the time, but kind of the way people use the F word in real life in terms of pain or seriousness, you know what I mean? But yeah, that being said, I'd give this series a 3.75. 3.75, almost 4-star. I think it would have been 4 stars if not for that weird subplot with these assassins. And again, if you watch it, you'll know what I'm talking about. Took me out. I was just a couple times where I'm just like, all right. That's enough. This is too much. And it didn't really connect to the rest of the show for me anyway. So yeah, 3.75 stars. Also, it was renewed for a second season. Now, I will say, I don't see how this show goes much beyond the plot that I just watched. I do not think it can improve beyond that, but I have been wrong before, and I would look forward to being wrong if we got a second season that was as exciting as this one was. So, yeah, with that, Leaving the Theater is a production of Oh, It's Big Ron Studios. Thomas Tyra of Bias Studios mixes the show. Thank you, Tom. Show art from Heather Wilder. Theme music by the mysterious Breakmaster Cylinder. For more information about The Night Agent, check out our show notes. You can follow me on Twitter, Instagram, and TikTok at Oh, It's Big Ron. That's at OHITSBIGRON. You can find out more about this show and other Oh, It's Big Ron Studios shows by following us on Instagram at Oh, It's Big Ron Studios and on Twitter at Oh, It's Big Ron Stew. That's STEW. Leaving the Theater will be back soon.
But until then, I'll be here on the couch.